What's going on? You got the almighty DJ CJ Flash back with a brand new live episode of I Remember That Song, and here to tell you all about it is the man, the myth, the legend, Mr. Jerry Dove.
CJ Flash. Dominus.
Thank you, brother. Thank you.
Left-handed.
Dominus.
Wait, just a little. Left hand don't work as well as the right. Dominus on
anyway. You need practice, bro.
Yeah, I do. I don't think I've ever done a left-handed Dominus on. What's good, brother? How you feeling?
Everything is everything, man. Happy to be alive, man. Yeah. Oh, and happy belated birthday to you, brother.
Oh, thank you very much, yes, man. I'm still getting birthday blessings, and that was last Friday, man.
Yeah, man.
It's nice to be loved. You know, it's nice to be loved. Yeah. So I really appreciate it. And for all you people who took a half a second to say happy birthday to me on Facebook and Instagram, give me about a week or two or three, and I will hit back every single one of you, because there's a lot of people, man.
Yeah.
A lot of people.
Yeah, it's a good look.
It's really, really nice.
A lot of love, man. You're loved and beloved.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Speaking of love, I'm loving that we're back with a live show.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
And while we've been off and on throughout the beginning of this 2024, in and out, mm-hmm. we had Eric Roberson mm-hmm. a couple of weeks ago. Is that our one show this month?
That's it. Because we were off the following week, and then we're here.
We were. Yes, we were. So yep. We had a good time last week for MLK Day as well. Thank you all for your support out there as well. So that was fun. Mm-hmm. And we're ready to roll, man. So let's bring in the people that are working with us tonight, the family, the friends. That's yes. looking at D Minor. We're looking at Dr. Dolores Thompson.
The good doctor. The good hey. Doctor.
We hey, got hey,
the
hey.
Top and the sixth top. How you doing, folks? Hey. 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 Out there, it's like there's four tops, and then there would be the fifth and the sixth. So that's...
We got it.
I'm retired.
I'm not people's got it, but we got it.
I'm gonna retire that joke. It's just
we're the top replacement team.
It's not fun, but it's still the A team because Russell Gatewood is in Africa. Mm-hmm. Ryan Nicole is in Cuba.
Good lord.
Ooh. I don't know who they're running from, but we're gonna act like
maybe they wanted to go home and visit home.
Nice.
For a little while.
Yeah,
we'll do that. So y'all ready? We're going to have some fun tonight.
Yes, we are.
Can't wait.
We got two of the founding members of Switch with us, Mr. Gregory Williams and Mr. Philip Ingram.
Wow.
I want to thank D Minor, the Encyclopedia Britannica, for introducing me to Gregory Williams a couple of years ago. We did a show with him a couple of years ago. It still remains one of my favorite shows that we've ever done. If you guys haven't seen it yet, go to our YouTube channel at IRTS Space Show. Scroll down and look for that show we did 2021, something like that.
Yeah.
Hilarious. And I think we're going to have just as much fun tonight, too. So I guess since Ryan's not here, I'm going to have to do this thing where we tell you all to watch and all like that. So look, you're looking at IRTS Live. We do this every Tuesday night, 7 p.m. Pacific time. We are here tonight, like I said, with our friends from Switch. We are a show that can be seen on YouTube, on X, which is formerly known as Twitter, and on Facebook at Soul TV, all across the Bay, all across the pond, all across the world. You can check us out tonight. You will see everybody who's watching. Make sure that you pop into town or the city or the state or the country that you're watching us for, so we can let everybody know that we got friends all over the world. And Soul TV, you can also check us out on Roku TV at soultvwatch.com. Ryan Nicole is so much better at that than me, but I tried my best. So I think I got the information out. We got the information out. We're good to go. All right, you guys ready? We're going to bring in our guests.
Let's do guests
it. Yes, you ready in the background? Here we go. Here's Greg Ray.
Hey, he is.
Good evening, y'all.
Gentlemen.
All right.
How are you guys doing, man?
I'm fantastic. Thank you.
I'm jamming, as always.
Okay, all right. And so look, we got your music things in the background. Let's do a close up here of what everybody's got on the wall here. Let's see this one. Gregory Salvatore. Wow. Nice little setup. You got your book on beside you there. You've been doing this before. That's nice.
Welcome to my living room.
You okay?
That's right.
Philip, we're going to take a look at what you got going on too.
Wow. Yep. Studio office.
Yeah.
Okay.
The gold and platinum, and then you get that air conditioner right in the middle. We need to work on that, bro.
Hey, man, it gets hot up in here. Hey, the only time I can't keep it, if I'm playing, I'm okay. But when I'm doing vocals, guess what? That thing got to get shut down.
Yeah. You're noisy in there.
So you be like sweating like Porky Pig's mama's mother. You know what I mean?
Porky.
So that's why the air conditioner's there.
Okay. Porky Pig's mama's mother.
That's you know what I'm saying?
Where are you from, bro? Where are you from talking like that? You're talking like
Akron, Ohio. Come on.
Okay, that how we talking
Akron? Minor should know that, right?
That's right.
Porky, yeah. I'm writing that one down.
Akron and them.
Okay.
These pigs, mamas.
You are really writing it down.
I'm really writing that down.
Mama's mother.
Hey, mama's mother. Okay. Mama's mother.
Hey, Jerry, you know how you made up some stuff?
Right off the
top? That's what I did.
Yeah. Well, obviously yours is a lot better than mine. You know, so.
Oh, because mine got some laughs.
Yeah, Philip.
That's funny. Hey, man. We just met. I'm just number love.
I'm already starting to think I like Gregory more, but it's okay.
Hey, right, it's so okay. Hey, watch. You're going to use this with nothing but love for the dove.
You know what that? Okay.
There you go.
Dove love.
And in that statement, he has totally redeemed.
But if I see that on your next show, I want some royalty.
There you go.
Okay.
Nothing but love for the dove. Wait a minute.
See, you can't even remember it. Before we get really started here, I was doing my research on you guys, and you know, you're all over the place. I think you need to get your lawyer because it's another group out here called Switch.
Oh,
I've been on that. That's a Christian group.
Wow.
Still don't mean they can't be sued, brother. Come on now.
No. I said I've been on it.
I'm wondering if somewhere down in Akron, Ohio, somebody booked Switch thinking, oh my gosh, you fellas don't come back, and these guys walked into the building.
But I'm absolutely sure that's happened to some degree. I mean, maybe not like you just painted it, but I'm sure people have made that mistake. That's why I had to look into it.
Wow. No, I didn't even know they existed.
Yeah, they are some kind of Christian group. I don't even know where they're from, but that's crazy, isn't it?
They're from, if I'm correct, they're from the Netherlands. Not anywhere in the U.S. Okay. Outside the country.
Wow.
Yeah. Well, I don't think they're affecting your gigs, and they are. You're all right. They're all right.
That's all right. They're infringing. That's all right. We got something for them.
Well, if I may borrow Philip's line, I want my little piece of that too, since I brought it to your attention. So.
You didn't introduce us to him. I already knew about him.
Oh, that's so you say. So you say.
Wink.
Mm-hmm. You never heard of that before I told him that. So. All right, that's how we open up the show. Let's say hello to a few folks that are watching now. You guys say hello to Vallejo, California.
Vallejo.
Somebody's saying happy birthday to me now. What you got to do, you guys, is you got to make sure that when you log in on Facebook, especially, that you put your name in there and tell them it's okay to use your name. That way I'll know who you are. Ron Ledford is always watching us from Detroit.
Right, that's right.
Lynette Washington, I believe, is in Oakland. Mm-hmm. Look at this. Good evening from Mississippi.
Mississippi.
Angel said she loves it. Somebody here says switch it up. Good evening. And good evening and good night. She said good hello and goodbye. Okay. We haven't even started yet, Adrian. Hold on.
Good night.
All right, so let's get this going. Okay. I'm talking way too much because I got all these talented people around me. Dolores. I'm so thankful that you are here, D Minor. I'm so thankful that you're here, CJ. You know, I got nothing but love for you. Mm-hmm. Gregory and Philip, let's have some fun like we're doing. We're going to talk about your music, tell all the stories you want. Let's educate these fans about why they love you so much. And keep in mind that you're going to be at Yoshi's in Oakland next Friday, February the 1st and the 2nd, 8 o'clock show each night. Two shows on Saturday night.
Thursday and Friday.
Yeah.
One show Friday night.
Yeah. I'm going to the 8 o'clock show on Friday, and it's going to be a lot of fun. So Thursday and Friday is when you're there. Friday. So tickets are still available. Go to yoshis.com. CJ Flash.
Yes, sir.
You ready to kick this show off?
You know I am.
Let's go.
Ooh.
Thought there was going to be some rock music until D Minor started doing the church dance. I didn't know where he was going with that. That one sounds like some old school music there. Is that one that sounds like one of your first? Tell me about that song, please.
In fact, that is not a Switch record. That's a pre-Switch record.
Oh, so, okay.
That's before I met Philip.
Yep.
That was off the White Heat album.
Fuck White Free. Heat.
Yep. Yep. And actually,
speaking of White Heat, boom.
That's White Heat.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
And wait a minute, let me give y'all an interesting tidbit that I just learned. I was with Barry White in 1973. Wow. That is what, 50 years ago?
Yeah.
I just learned
now, couple, 51.
Okay. And I just learned a couple weeks ago. Well, I was explaining to somebody how we got the name White Heat. Barry White named us White Heat.
Mm-hmm.
And then a day or so later, there was this article I happened to read about Barry White. Come to find out, when he started his singing career, he was going to name himself White Heat, but the record company didn't like it. So he backed away from it and put Barry Eugene White out there. And then along come us a year or so later, a couple of years later, and he named us White Heat. Although Jerry, if you remember, CJ, if you remember, I told y'all he took the damn name back in the bass player at the same time when he dropped us.
He wasn't going to handle Christian Company switching, stealing his stuff.
Not at all.
He put an elbow on that.
Not at all.
Took it back.
But
the White Heat, yeah.
Intense that he, you know, that he held that name. He gave it to us and he took it back. That's why he took it back. Okay, keep your name, Barry.
So it looks like there's about 8 guys in that group. So you always had to split that money up a whole lot of ways. Just like having a lot of folks around you guys. Is that what you do?
Oh, you don't want me to tell you about the money. You don't want me to tell you about the money. But anyway,
maybe a little later after that scotch kicks in, I definitely want to hear you coming out of the money.
It wasn't under split up, trust me.
Okay.
Wasn't under split up. Long story.
Mm-hmm. All right. Y'all jump in when you want to. So otherwise, keep it going, Flash.
Got you covered. That sounds like a Barry White groove.
In fact, Barry White wrote that song. That was the only song he contributed to the album.
Wow.
Oh, okay.
And you know what? I hear that song, and I hear the sourpuss horns, and I hear them bad mixes on there, and all I'm saying is thank God for Switch.
Okay.
But, I mean, I'm proud of my years and what I did over the years and all the things with it, but I hear the difference in sound quality and vocal quality and horns didn't sound like we were playing tin cans. Trust me. Thank God for Switch.
It did sound a little 1970s black exploitation film-ish.
It sounded 1965 back year exploitation. Thank God. I'm telling you, that band should have never come out. My money and God. I was proud of it then. Stuck my chest out, told my neighbor. About it, he said, "Boy, that record ain't nothing." I went on the made a thing. So thank God for Switch. Excuse me, I just had to interject.
Well, so needless to say, the maestro had a lot of control over what was happening.
Oh yeah,
absolutely.
So Greg, with White Heat, being that was the precursor to Switch, who were some of the other members, if any, that were in White Heat that eventually came with you to join Switch?
Bobby and Jody. Actually, and believe it or not, I told y'all the story about Barry White taking the name back, stealing our bass player. Well, Tommy DeBarge came in for him for that bass player. But that's right. If Barry took the name back, White Heat, Tommy didn't play with White Heat. Tommy played with this band. That's all we're going to have to name them, is this band at that time. But anyway, Tommy, Bobby, and Jody were all part of that, the pre-switch era.
Okay.
So did Barry White put you guys all together, or did you know Tommy and Bobby and everybody before?
Well, I grew up with Bobby and Tommy, first of all. And I got a phone call asking me to come and be a trumpet player for a group out of Steubenville, Ohio, called TNT Flashers. I was in college at the time. And I got the call, and I told him I'd come if I could bring Bobby with me, because me and Bobby had gotten tight over the previous 3 years, really close, you know, family-wise, and all that stuff. So I got Bobby in the band, and we took off, and we went to Phoenix, Arizona, to be with the TNT Flashers, who maybe 6-8 months later went to California, signed with Barry White, and became Whitey. There's a whole lot more to that story, but I'm trying to cut to the chase and not stretch it out too long.
Nice.
Okay. What was Barry White like as a musician and as a businessman, but also personally in being around him?
Well, first and foremost, as a musician, you know as much as I do because of the great records that he created. Talented cat, period. Okay. I dare say this, I'm in a band with 8 members and we've had roadies and stuff. So there's 13 of us. And of the 13 of us, there was very little time for us to have a lot of one-on-ones with Barry White. Fortunately, in a few situations, he kind of singled me out and included me. So I was the benefit of a few conversations that, you know, that came out of that whole era, that whole situation. And Barry was cool, far as I was concerned. I mean, there were some things to be learned, like never give your name to a record company. Okay. Right. And a few other things. Mm-hmm. You know, like know what you're signing, because believe it or not, after I left Barry White, I learned to read and write a contract backwards and forwards. I had to protect myself. Even though Switch had attorneys and all of that, I pretty much learned and knew what the conversation was so I could communicate as well, because it's important and everything you do thereafter. So there were lessons learned directly and indirectly from Barry White. And the funny thing about this is that after Barry White dropped the group and stole the bass player and changed the name, a year and a half later, 2 years later, here comes Switch, and we're with Jermaine, and who's Barry White's best friend but Jermaine, or who's Jermaine's best friend but Barry White?
Wow.
That's right.
Philip can take the file on that one.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Now, you talk about reading contracts and all. I know I saw an interview you did with someone where you started your own little organization about helping people in the music industry and knowing all about that. Tell us about that.
It's in the works right now. It's called Legacy Royalty Recovery Specialists. And I and 3 young partners in various aspects of the music industry are now, we just recently formulated, we're getting all our ducks in a row by really 2024, we're going to launch. And what our intent and our aim is to help folks get their royalties back. Because quite frankly, Switch signed with Motown in 1977. We didn't see a royalty check from Motown until, tell them, Philip, when?
Well, for me, it was last year. Yours was the year before.
Wow. So,
yeah, okay, that's right. Because I was, yeah.
Wow. But so, years. So in the words of Funkadelic, not just knee deep, that was totally deep. I'm gonna stop here.
For real. For real.
So I take it they didn't give you like no back pay or nothing like that. And they didn't load it.
Hell
up
no, and... man. I had to have surgery on my back. Nobody paid me nothing.
I mean, we did have advances and stuff when we signed, but yeah, it was like I said, it was deep.
Okay, and what you should know, and I tried to make a joke, but what you should know is this. There's a statute of limitations on retroactive pay. So in some situations, if you're fortunate, you can go beyond 7 years. You know, but it's a rarity that you can go beyond 7 years in the life of a contract and claim monies. And some people can't even go back that far. But what me and my young partners are planning to do, we're trying to help those that can't afford to get an attorney to go help them get their money straight, that can't afford to hire accountants, that don't know that they got money over here in China or money over here in Japan. We're trying to pull together so that we can help them do all of those things. And not only that, we're in an era now where copyrights are being overturned as well. Meaning, I'm paraphrasing it, but let's say 33 years, a copyright can revert back to the original creator of the of the work, let's say. Well, you have a short window to go get your money. And if you don't get it within that short window, 1 year, 2 years, or whatever that is, then it reverts back to the person that had it before, who really ain't entitled to it. So we're also planning to not do that work, but farm that work out to like folks like my friend Kerry Gordy, who did something right. similar to that for Switch a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So anyway, yeah, but the thing is to help folks stop getting ripped off.
Okay.
Not just black, not just white, not just R&B, not just hip hop, all of it. Whoever we can help, because it's important to me that I can lead the planet, leaving that behind as part of my legacy. That right. I help somebody in ways that I cried out for help and I didn't get.
Nice. So once again, it's Legacy Royalty Recovery Process
Specialist.
Specialist. Okay. So
yeah, and actually that information is up on my website as well, which is www.switchentertainmentworld.com, where all things Switch live. Is where I did it sound like a halfway radio announcer.
Well, you all the way there. That's good news. Great information. That's good for you to be working on that, man. Get back.
Yeah. It's important.
The work that you're doing is super important because so many people did miss out on so much. I remember when Kashif came out with the book, The Better Record Industry, and everybody really ate that up and got a great education from it. So I'm excited to see how people are going to be helped by what you're doing, especially in education of arts.
I thank you. It's so important. It's so important because, I mean, it can make the difference in somebody not having to go to jail. It can make the difference in somebody going to college. It can make the difference of somebody having a leg amputated when they need it versus dying because of it. Damn. It can make a world of difference. And that we know, me and my guys, we know. So we talk about that. And it's about the mission. It ain't about the payday. It's about the mission. The payday is the end result, seeing somebody's life benefit from their own work.
Right. Well, we definitely follow your progress on that, and God bless you for what you're doing, man.
Thank
Keep
you.
That music going, CJ Flash.
Got you covered. You spoke about Jermaine Jackson, right?
Yeah.
I'm endlessly, I'm helplessly, I'm perfectly in love with you.
That's CJ Flash on the ones and twos, always playing songs at least once or twice that I don't know what he's talking about. I never heard that song. So it sounds good. I like it, but I don't know that song.
You wait a minute, Philip, you're not on that version, are you?
Yeah, that's I was gonna say that that's one? Me. That's me that's singing. Yeah.
The one. I know you and Jermaine did the bulk of the work.
Right. And then you and Bobby did One High. That was technically supposed to be on our third album, Reaching for Tomorrow. And it ended up not making that album. And then it came out like in a special edition later after we had left Motown. Mm-hmm. But that song was technically recorded for the Reaching for Tomorrow album.
Absolutely.
Now, tell us the name of the song.
Tahiti Hut.
Tahiti
Hut. And I'm singing the lead that I'm helplessly.
Yeah.
And me and Jermaine did the backgrounds and Bobby did the high.
Mm-hmm. And you know what? And I knew that the song, it must be the mix because it's different than I think the tempo is faster.
Right.
And something else is going on. The mix is a lot fuller. The one that actually is on YouTube right now.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, remember, they didn't release it until after we had already left Motown.
Right.
And it came out as part of a special edition.
One of them compilations.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
So we still have a lot of stuff that the public has never heard, you know, because you always record more than it's going to actually make the album.
So that album, Reaching for Tomorrow, the third album, and which is the one with the globe. So one thing I can say about that album, one of my favorite albums, but it was kind of bifurcated. And was there
kind of what? I'm sorry.
Yeah, I was gonna say, what's that word? D-minor? What was that word?
Bifurcated.
Bifurcated.
You have to edumacate me. Yeah.
No, but
you're taking that encyclopedia thing a little too far, man. Talk English to us. Talk regular folks stuff. What you talking about? Man?
I heard that word. Right. I know.
Okay. I'm sorry, y'all. No, no, but with that album, I noticed that everybody was kind of doing their own thing as far as being a producer and things like that. So that switch thing kind of definitely took it to another level where, you know, everybody was off really recording their own songs. So was that a song in particular that was produced by you and Jermaine Phillip?
No, not at all. Actually, that was a song that was presented to us by Earth and Fire's camp. I think Maurice and
Amanda O'Donnell.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, they wrote that. And Jermaine had got hip to it and he shared it with us.
Wow.
But yeah, that Jermaine produced that, didn't he, Gray?
Yes, he did. And not only that, if I'm correct, did not Kathy Wakefield write those lyrics, Philip?
No, it was Roxanne Seaman.
Roxanne.
Yeah.
Right, it was Roxanne.
Because she's reached out to me recently. We back in touch.
And, yeah, me too. I've been in touch with her on Facebook. Yeah.
And she said that's how we actually met. So
that's what it was.
Okay. Yeah. So that was Roxanne. Nice.
Now, the thing on this show is that whenever anybody says Earth, Wind, and Fire, this guy's ears perk up because CJ Flash is an Earth, Wind, and Fire fanatic. So so if you borrow music from their camp, that sounds good to him. Now, Jermaine, now we've had people over the years tell us a lot of different stories about Jermaine. That brother's kind of secretly talented on a lot of things that we don't really know, do we?
Oh, yeah, Jermaine was phenomenal.
Yes,
matter of fact, I'll say this, because I was 18 years old when Switch got signed to Motown. Mm-hmm. And studio-wise, vocally and everything, we learned a lot from him. Right. I mean, because you got to realize they had already had, the Jackson 5 had already had a slew of hits. Mm-hmm. And when the brothers went to CBS, he stayed back. He was married to Hazel at the time. But, I mean, you know, because it's interesting when you record, when you play live, you tend to go faster. And then when you're in the studio, I mean, we were first doing our stuff. He's like, man, y'all brothers need to slow down. Pull it back. Like, mm-hmm. Lay in that pocket. He helped us to like, come on, man, it's here. In our minds, it felt slow. Mm-hmm. So you actually had to get used to that tempo. You know, live, you might go a little faster. But no, the harmonies and everything, learned a lot with him.
Wow.
Matter of fact, I'm going to share this story. When we were doing I Want to Be Closer, which was, this is a whole nother Oprah, but it was written by Jermaine and Greg. But when it came out, it just said Jermaine on the record. But like I said, that's a whole nother Oprah. But we don't say a whole nother Oprah. That's a whole nother show. Take too much time.
Well, I'm saying legacy royalty recovery specialist. Hello.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
We have another case for you. But go ahead, please.
But no, when it was presented, so that little he had this little da, 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 da. It was like just this melody, and he was like, man, I want some serious harmonies. And he didn't know that Eddie was classically trained, and so we like, man, Eddie can do that. And he was like, Eddie, because Eddie was really unassuming. Like,
right. Eddie?
And I said, trust me. He went over to the piano and those harmonies became part of our signature, that four part, the girl I'll be. And I mean, and when we did it, because, you know, we were used to three parts, but Eddie was giving us these notes. We was like, wait a minute, Greg, go over there. Wait.
I mean,
but when we did it and it came together, I still remember Jermaine. He's like, man, you guys sound like some angels. I mean, he was just, he was blown away.
Nice.
And you
became our signature. Say what again?
You talking about Eddie Flewellen?
Eddie Flewellen, yeah. Because Eddie and I was in a local band in Akron, Ohio. And when Greg and them, White Heat ended up moving to Akron, kind of part way to Grand Rapids and Steubenville. And that's how we met when I was like 16 years old. And me and Eddie was in the same group. And I introduced Greg to Eddie. We were in a local band. Howard Hewitt was in another band. My brother James was in another local band.
Wow.
we talked to, who did we talk to a couple weeks ago about all that music coming out of Ohio, man? Just ridiculous. Oh, we talked to Zapp, the fellow from Zapp.
Oh, yeah. We used to do shows with them.
Man.
They're from Dayton.
Yeah. Yeah, we there's so much going on. I was born in Ohio. I didn't get any of those musical gifts. Not one of them. Not one.
But that's okay. But you got this show, man.
Yeah, to get the gap.
See? There you go.
Gift of gab.
See, yeah. Philip, you just elevated yourself back above Gregory, man. I appreciate you like that.
Yeah, I told you, man.
My favorite member switch is
hey,
now
man,
at 7:35 p.m. My favorite member switch is Philip Ingram. That's
the end of the show. Hey, Greg, all I'm doing is giving love to the dove. So
I heard your brother.
See?
Even DDT, even DDT gonna take that one.
I'm a true lyricist. I am going to take that one.
Love to the dove.
And you're watching IRTS Live. It's Tuesday night. That means we're on. We've got the fellas from Switch. That's Gregory Williams and Philip Ingram. They're going to be at Yoshi's in Oakland, February the 1st and February the 2nd. One show on Thursday, two shows on Friday. I'm going Friday at 8 o'clock. If you would like to show up and buy me a Hennessy and Coke, I'll have a table right around. You'll find me. You'll let me let you know. And we are playing the music of these fellas and have some great time, some stories. I want to say hello to some of the people that are watching us. Byron Gibson has been in and out here all night long. He's a musician here in the Bay, so he's always got something he wants to talk about when we get folks like you on. James Andrews is watching. Roy Stone, DJ Roy Stone is watching. Saba G. Scott, Kelly Armstrong says hello. Tony Johnson, just all kind of folks out there. We really appreciate you. Teresa Johnson and Deidre Stitches is watching, CJ.
Hey,
so we appreciate it, man. So we got a good show going tonight. So tell your friends to come on and watch and join us with us. Dr. Dolores is here. D. Miner's here. CJ Flash is here. I'm Jerry. Let's go, Flash. Keep that music going. Got quiet, didn't we? All got real quiet. Everybody's in their thoughts right there, man.
But that harmony I was talking about, that was Eddie that put those arrangements together.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Show you how long ago I was? I was 19 when I sang that.
Wow. Okay.
Mm. 19 years old.
Mm. Can you still hit them notes?
Oh, let me, you know, I'm glad you asked that question. No, seriously.
Okay.
This is what's interesting. You're going to see when the people come to show.
Yes.
They are amazed because, you know, we're all older. The answer to your question is yes. We do every song that we recorded in the same key that we did them in when we were teenagers.
Wow.
We have not dropped any keys on none of our stuff.
Wow.
Absolutely.
And you'll see it next week. And that's what people are like, dang, well, y'all still sound like the record, which is a compliment.
That part.
Oh, definitely a compliment. Big compliment. Wow.
But yeah, no, seriously. That's one thing I appreciate about, you know, with Switch, everybody didn't kept their chops up and everything, and
mm-hmm. you know, here's the only thing that's
musically and, you know, vocally.
Here's the only thing that's switched about you, Philip. Here's the only thing. Boom, where'd the hair go, bro?
Hey, man. I did the love for the dove for the time that was needed.
That's a Larry Graham special right there.
That is
right.
Larry Graham special. Okay.
You should have donated that hair when you put that off.
Okay.
That's what we used to call the Lord Jesus.
Oh, good Lord.
That's beautiful. Matter of fact, in looking at the group, did you guys like have a rule that everybody had to have good hair or you couldn't be in Switch? Is that the deal?
One of them.
Them naturals are tight, man. I love that.
Hey, little pretty boys up
there. Hey, Jerry, let me tell you something. We talked about this in the show. Greg had an interesting vision, and he wanted guys, he said, that look good. Now, this is interesting, right? Mm-hmm. That can play more than one instrument and can sing lead and background.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, And so, you know, he met different ones and all of us could. And we didn't know we were going to be switched, but when we did our showcase for Motown, I would be out front singing, Bobby would be on keyboards, Greg would be on his trumpet, Ada would be on the trombone. Bobby would go out front, I get on the keyboards. Bobby and I do a duet, they get on the keyboards. Bobby at one point went to the drums, Jody came out. Long story short, Suzanne DePass, after our showcase, it was Barry Gordy, Suzanne DePass, Tony Jones, I mean, Jermaine, it was like, and they said, I mean, she was like, I've never seen so much switching in my life. Because everybody was, you know, and this was Greg's vision, but it wasn't something like we thought about. It was just like, hey, man, can you cover this? Okay, I got that. You know, that's how it was. But she's the one that honed in on that. We're like, huh. And that's how we got the name Switch.
Wow. That's amazing.
So it's funny. The original members can play multiple instruments, but Akili, who replaced Bobby, always teased him because, you know, don't take this wrong, but in Switch, he just sings, right? And so, like, when I'm out front singing, he's like, man, what am I going to do? I'm going to give me some drumsticks. I said, yeah, you better go to KFC. No, but we have fun, but it sounds funny. But no, it's like, it's just the original members can play multiple instruments and sing and, you know, sing and play.
And I do have to, I have to admit to the fact that as we grow older, things change and we don't run around the stage like we used to and switch instruments like that. And a girl asked me, she said, y'all sound good after she saw the show, but do y'all still switch like y'all used to? I said, baby, the only switch we doing is standing up or sitting down.
That's okay. That's okay. We are happy to see you there.
Well, Greg, actually, what, you stopped playing your trumpet for a while, right?
I stopped playing on the early Switch records. I put the thing away.
Okay. Because, you know, when you play, I used to do a lot of work with Wayne Henderson.
Oh, wow. And
for years, he had put his trombone away, you know, and he was legendary with the Crusaders because he was doing a lot of production. Yeah. So after about 20, it was funny because I was working with him doing his time. After about 20 years, he picked it up and thought he was going to be able to, but you lose, what's it called, the amateur or something like that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He had lost that. And he was like, man, I'm Wayne. I said, Wayne, you got to go back to basics. And he said, it was this old guy said, well, you Wayne Henderson, but man, you got to go back. And he started him back going, poo, poo.
Right.
He had to build back up. And it took him literally almost a year. Wow. And then before he died, no, he was still playing phenomenal.
Amazing.
Yeah. But you do lose that with horns. But with keyboards and stuff, you know.
I stopped over 30 years ago. Mm. Last February, I got this bug up my butt, and all of a sudden, I'm going to buy me a new horn. I went out and bought me a horn, and I started trying to get there. It's on the top of the bookshelf. I bought it in such a way it's been there since March. From last year.
Not everybody can do that. Not everybody can do it.
Some things are better left alone.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. No, for horns, it takes a while to get that back.
Yeah. Y'all don't have the lung capacity anymore. I don't have the lip for it anymore. And I don't have the patience.
Now I hear you.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So look, here's a comment from Sarah. When Bobby sang this song live in Oakland, I think he could have taken home every single woman that wanted to cheat. Wait, every single woman that wanted to cheat would have gone home with him or something like that. So, okay.
Yeah. Right. She talking about back in the day?
Yeah, back in the way long time ago.
Oh, okay.
Ago. Not now.
Of course. Yeah.
No comment. Everybody's no comment. Okay. So.
No, that's a dead conversation, man. What are we talking about up here? No. I got what she was saying. She's talking about back in 81, and she's absolutely right. Actually, we all could back then. But okay, what do we do with them now?
No. You'd ask me. Can you help me with my chair, please, baby? That's what you'd be saying right now.
Stand up and sit down.
Keep that music going, Flash.
All right.
That's it. Yeah. I think I got it now. From left to right, from side to side, we rock the town. And one thing we'll keep in mind is a country sound. With fingers snapping, hands snapping.
basement fucking, keyboards ringing, voices counting, all these things it takes to make the best sound.
Well, see, Switch can do more than just sing ballads and stuff like that, right? Right?
Yeah, that was dope.
There you go.
We could do anything, man. Musically, we could do anything. Everybody played different stuff and wrote different stuff, and we could do anything. The question is, what could we get paid to do? Ooh. And that was the reality of it all, because who was in charge of making sure the payday was Berry Gordy. So he got it the way he saw it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you know,
Berry Gordy, you know, a lot of people talk about his reputation of really taking over and him having that ear for hits. I read somewhere that he tried to pair you guys up with Ray Parker Jr. as a producer. And I know you guys are famously known for producing your own stuff once you got to Motown. Not that. How'd that work for you?
It did not work. It's funny too, Philip. Damien, I was on his show a couple of days ago, and he raised the same question.
Hmm.
D Minor did here.
Oh, okay. Anyway,
and the thing was is that Ray was good for what Ray was doing at the time. I actually wrote a couple songs with him during that period where we were trying to get him involved with Switch, but it didn't really work for the overall.
Hmm.
You know, there's just like some acts that just have their own identity, even if it's at an embryo stage, they got their own thing, and you can't just put no anybody in on it. For example, let's talk about when Warner Brothers was interested in signing Prince, and they tried to put him with Maurice White.
That's right.
Maurice White, Earth, Wind & Fire ain't nothing but incredible hits. But can you imagine that? I don't see that union. Mm-hmm. Well, Prince definitely did not see it, stood against it, held his ground, and got it the way he needed it, and look how he evolved from that. Mm-hmm, see, everybody good ain't for good for everybody.
Right.
That's what I'm saying.
Right. That's right.
I love Ray. I mean, we're friends, and I love to work with him, and I love the little things that we did together. But it wasn't the right thing for Switch, so it wasn't going to happen.
I've worked with Ray outside of Switch on different projects and stuff as well.
Wow. Okay.
Go ahead, Dolores.
Yeah, I was just saying it's good for, I know some of my students from Oakland School for the Arts are watching, to remember to stand your ground is what he's saying. Stand your ground and stand up for what you believe in, even if it's somebody as powerful as a Berry Gordy.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The whole thing is this. As long as you know who you are, then you can teach the rest of them what they don't know. They'll never let nobody tell you you can't, because you can if you know you can. And you will if you're persistent and you hang in there.
Yeah.
For example, there was another policy in the industry of owning names. The record company owning the name of the artist. That was policy. It didn't start with the black artists. It started with white artists, all of them, because Berry put it succinctly in their motivation behind it. And Berry said, if you remember this one, Philip, we don't fatten frogs for snakes.
Yep.
Mm.
Yep.
Meaning that we're not going to invest money in you for somebody else to come along and take advantage of it.
Mm.
Right.
So we need to own everything of you that we can own, including your name.
Wow.
When it came to Switch, I kept getting hit upside the head with Barry White taking the name back.
Mm-hmm.
So when they wanted the name Switch, I said, no. No. Hell no. I'll go back to Grand Rapids work in the factory before you guys get to own the name Switch.
Mm-hmm.
And things kind of shut down for a couple of weeks. And I thought at any day they're going to kick us out the hotel, because Motown was paying the hotel.
Go ahead.
I really did. But the whole thing of it was is I knew the value of the name. I really didn't know the industry as well as I would come to know it. But I knew that name had value. Barry White could just take it from us and shut us down. Well, Barry, y'all didn't come up with that name. Right. Y'all ain't got no right to try to take that name.
Right.
So anyway.
One of the big ones I remember is the Moments.
Yeah.
When they decided to leave and they had to, who was it?
Ray Goodman and Brown.
It became Ray Goodman and Brown. But the lady who was running the label, Sylvia Robinson.
Sylvia Robinson.
Yeah, right.
They decided we own the Moments. So they took and made it Ray Goodman and Brown. Same group for y'all who don't know. But that's crazy, man. That's crazy.
Well, you all that work. The Jackson 5 had to leave the Jackson 5 behind and become the Jackson.
Right.
Sure. The Temptations had to give up all future royalties. So the stories go on and on and on about record companies owning the names. Mm-hmm. It's an insult to the artist, to tell you the truth. But
I'll give you another one. Jefferson Airplane became Jefferson Starship, became right. Starship.
That's right. That's right.
Right.
Yeah. And it sounds like three different groups, but they're all the same group.
Right.
That's so right. When you serious question here. So how can you build up any trust and any love and respect for these people when you know that this is just always lurking around the corner? I mean, you know, we all hear great things about Berry Gordy. We hear bad things about Berry Gordy, but how can you respect them? Or your eyes are so wide open. You just want to get in there and do your music that you're willing to take whatever hit you have to. Is that what it is?
In a lot of cases, yes. But the reality of it is this, guys, even though I took stances and explained things the way I explain them, the reality, it's a business. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
It's a business. And the truth of the matter is who you think is robbing you really ain't robbing you. It's your ignorance that's robbing you. Mm. It's sad. As a kid, you don't know. You just don't know. And as a black kid, you're not getting much education about that. I got passionate about it, y'all. That business. And you can't blame everybody else for what you don't know.
Right.
They're just doing business normally. Barry stepped in and had the same cookie cutter patterns as the white boys had all those years. Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess because black folks are passionate and we think we all family and all that you're wrong for doing that to us. Man, I'm running a company. Mm-hmm. And it is my finance. It's my benefit, the less you know. So I ain't going to teach you. And Barry was actually, I think Barry shared some knowledge with us that we could have carried on through our involvement and even now. And I don't know if we were the only ones that he did that with. But I don't feel betrayed or robbed by Barry, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they'd kept that name, I would have. I don't know. I might have went Vietnam on and did something. But
you know what? But seriously, when
what does Vietnam mean? What does that mean?
Just crazy.
Yeah, crazy.
Okay.
Those explosions and stuff like that when I think about it.
All right. So, Your Honor, I thought he was joking when he said that on the show. I have no no connection to anything that may or may not happen in the future with Mr. Gordy's via Mr. Gray. Okay. Anyway, go ahead, Philip. Go ahead, bro.
No, I was going to say, honestly, when we when we did our showcase, Barry came to us and, you know, they had a little meeting and he wanted to meet with us because Jermaine, he had already heard our demo and, you know, he came. I remember we got there on we're doing some rehearsing that Friday. He came and said, "Hey, you guys got the deal." In other words, we had to still work out some things, but he said, "We got to do a showcase because ain't nobody heard you but me." And he was just so excited about us. But when Barry heard us, I remember me and Greg was riding back home together and he said, "Man, I'm behind you guys. The only thing that can mess you guys up is you." I'll never forget those words.
Wow.
And I was like, wow. So when we first got signed, we had meetings at Motown, but the majority of our meetings was at Berry Gordy's home. He had us come up there and he was grooming us. I mean, we did Soul Train and stuff, and he would tell us, you know, just little things to, you know, because one thing I give Motown as far as artist development, think about it. They've taken some guys from the projects, as it were, made them household names.
Absolutely.
So they know how to do that stuff. Dress them. Matter of fact, our first album, exact same music, but it had a totally different album cover. And then it was like, Barry saw this. He said, "No, what is this?" He scrapped it. Same music, did a totally different photo shoot, sent us to different hairdressers, had us with a clothes designer. Her name was Siri. She took us shopping. I mean, did the album cover that you see, you know, with the squares and stuff on it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That album went platinum. So that's how much he was into it. Now I'm going to have to tell you about, like, that one. Exactly. But now with the one with the world, and I talked about this on Unsung. And I'm just going to be honest. Our first two albums, I felt like we were a group still.
Yeah.
But after you get some hit records, people say, you know, the worst thing about success is a little bit, right? Mm. And we, you know, got some gold platinum albums. That's great. But, I mean, Commodores was getting multi-platinum. Earth, Wind was getting, you know, multi-platinum. Like, yeah, man, we still got some work to do. So there's a song on our third album. It's called Power to Dance. And energy, great, everything. We're up at Barry Gordy's home. And by this time, you know, we're known. And but I love Bobby, you know, this talent and everything. But Barry said, I think this song is a, now you're talking about Barry Gordy. He said, I think this song is a number one record. The music is phenomenal. I love everything about it, but the lyrics aren't as strong as the melody or the song. So Bobby said, well, I think the lyrics are fine. I was 20 years old and I put my head down and I said, wow, you know, lost his monkey mind. I'm sorry. I was like, yep, go ahead and say that. But now if you look at the album, the logo is different. There's no picture. I was like, they're sending us a message.
They sure did. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Sure did.
Yeah.
And that's why that album, like you were talking about, D Minor, because actually, when it came on the charts, it was, we were thinking My Friend in the Sky was going to be the single.
Yeah.
And he went with Don't Take My Love Away. But from the momentum of those first two albums, that thing came on the charts and jumped 80-something spots in the first week. And it was like unheard of. But then Motown didn't get behind it. So those 80 spots just start getting lost and lost. And so, but that's what happened. And after that, we wasn't back up at Barry's house anymore.
Okay, well, let me expound a little bit, just a little bit here.
Yeah.
When Bobby told Barry that he thought the lyrics were fine, he said that with an attitude.
Yeah. Mm.
A nasty attitude.
Yep.
And it was like, to me, it would have been a slap in the face. I agree. You were Barry Gordy, somebody who's trying to take you someplace, and somebody who's just sharing a little wisdom, right, as not only the owner of the record company, but as a creator, as a hit songwriter, as somebody who knows, and somebody who's going to put all his money behind us, as he had,
yep,
up until that point.
Yep.
And to tell him in the way that I think is fine, other than that, shut up, old man, and sit down.
Yep. You might, and we had his house. We had his house.
At his house.
Yeah.
That was it. That's the last time. We ain't been up to that house since.
Let
me just say this.
Okay. Yeah.
So me and Greg, you know, I said, we went back to when we did our showcase. Barry said, the only thing that's going to mess us up is us. You.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And as a unit, yeah, we were still, but that's when that separation and stuff started happening. I'm like,
absolutely.
Yeah, it's, and I'm going to tell you, my brother James, you know, because Switch got famous before he got famous.
Yeah.
But we, he's the reason, because he was 6 years older than me. He was the reason I got in the music industry. When he was 14, he got in his first band. I was 8, and he used to take me in rehearsals, and I was hooked. So James was around, and he said, first couple albums, he said, man, yo, he loved the guys and everything. And one day he said, hey man, some of these guys ain't the same guys I met when y'all first came to LA. And I knew what he was talking about.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Getting these hit records and your head starting to.
Yep.
So, and that was the beginning of the end, in essence.
Wow. That's unfortunate. When you get this many people together, they're gonna all want to try to do their own thing. I'm surprised nobody tried to go solo. I thought that's where you were going to, one of the stories, that maybe somebody wanted to go solo.
Well, Bobby did end up going solo.
That was Bobby's case at that point. That he, you know, oh, he wanted to run the show the way he wanted to run it. But it was about a group of six, not a group of one.
Mm-hmm.
And as bad as you want to leave, I want you to leave.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and that's how a globe got put on that damn album cover.
Yep.
Okay. Because at that point, I just say this: I was not gonna let Bobby DeBarge destroy it for all of us.
Yeah. Right.
As best I could, and that was my little brother. I love him to this day dearly, but I'm not gonna go along with wrong, and I'm definitely not one for self-destruction.
Mm-hmm.
I can't preach on one hand, believe in yourself and go for it, and then on the other hand, get up and do things wrong and destroy stuff. So that wasn't going to work for us, bottom line. And that's when it began to go like this. And even though it came back together and we came up with an album, This Is My Dream, and we got a hit Love over and over again, still, it didn't go where it was supposed to go. That Commodore, that Earth, Wind & Fire level, it did not go there. And it was destined to go there from the gate, because the talent and the look was definitely there.
Mm-hmm. And y'all did have a song called Believe in Yourself. Right. End it.
Yeah, that's right. And I'm going to share this with you, too. The demo that we did for Motown, Bobby was not a part of the demo. Mm. At the time, he was having some other issues. And we had this guy that was with Gregnum, a guy by the name of Arnie Haynes. And so when we did our demo, we did it in Columbus, Ohio in a couple of weeks, 8 songs. That's when Greg and Jody went out to California. And after we got this interest in Motown, for some reason, Arnie decided not to come. And we're like, what? Mm-hmm. And so it's like, Greg's like, man, we got a deal on the table. So that's when he reached back out to Bobby. That's because true. We had this deal on the table that Motown was already interested in. They mm-hmm. had never heard of Bobby DeBarge. And then he was like, Greg said, we were just worried because of the drug thing. Greg said, hey, man, he's clean. What do you guys think? And we like, of course, talent. Yeah, but because, you know, Tommy was with us. But it was that thing. And so, and he came out, like I said, first 2 albums, honestly, I would say we were still a group.
Yeah.
Because me, Greg, Bobby, and Tommy, we rented a house together. Jody was married and Eddie was with a girl at the time. And so we had a band house. No furniture in the living room. It was our instruments. So that way we could just get up and write. And mm-hmm. that was a, you know, nice little neighborhood and everything. And but that's, we would shed it there. So it saved us money as opposed to, you know, renting a studio to. And mm-hmm. so we wrote all our songs in there. So it was pianos, drums, everything. My congas was set up. Wow. So the 4 of us lived together. But again, we were a band. But by mm-hmm. the 3rd album, it was about, no, it's about me. I'm like, mm-hmm. how did this get about you?
Yeah.
So
did Arnie sing in the same falsetto as Bobby DeBarge when he
sure did.
Yeah.
And he was an incredible singer. Only yep. thing is I do say about Arnie, like it's a stereotype and it's not a negative because I have much respect for Stylistics, the Delphonics, the Blue Magics, the Ray Goodman and Brown, but they all sound the same. And yes. Arnie sounded like them.
Yep.
I have never in my life met a more unique sounding individual than Bobby DeBarge. To me, Bobby DeBarge, not because I knew him and loved him and grew up with him, because it's incomparable. I love Philip Bailey. Sing his butt off. Eddie Kendricks, I love before Philip Bailey. But nobody greater than Bobby DeBarge, mm-hmm. according to Greg Williams.
And I agree. He was definitely one of my favorite falsetto singers.
Absolutely.
Because he was very unique in the way the way he would approach songs. And like I said, we had a lot of fun together. And here's what was interesting to me that I did not know until we were watching the Unsung before it came out. Mm-hmm. We were over some friend's house, and I know Bobby had called me to help him with some backgrounds, and I knew Tommy had played on the record, but I didn't know that Greg had helped him with some production. So
songs with him.
Yeah, and I'm sitting up here. I'm like, wait a minute, Greg. I looked at Greg. I said, wait a minute, Bobby doing a solo record that I'm singing on, that Tommy's playing on, that Greg is on. I'm like, that's 4 members of Switch. I'm like,
and okay, and wait a minute, put it in perspective, because this was his deathbed album. This was mm-hmm. the last album he did before.
Yeah,
he
got it was.
That's what he's referring to.
Yeah, but still, you know,
he came back for us.
Yes, that's the point.
Because he knew that's where he had life. That's where he was sustained.
Sure.
But he found that out too late. He found that out on the back end of it.
Yeah,
and it was too late for that.
Guys, great stories, great stories. You're watching IRTS Live with members of Switch, Gregory Williams and Philip Ingram. We've got my girl Dolores with us. We got Encyclopedia Brown Tanica D Minor with us. The almighty DJ CJ Flash is with us. And what did you call me, Philip? Jerry Dove Love.
Love to the Dove, man. Love to the Dove.
We're showing love to the Dove.
Love to the Dove.
So, hey, you know you're going to start using that. Hey, Greg, I'm going to get some folks up in Oakland and find out about that.
Absolutely.
Because you know what's going to happen. This is IRTS. Make sure you show some love to the Dove. I'm Jerry Dove. And
then after that, you call Legacy Royalty Retriever Specialist.
Don't push and shove. Just show
our next
love.
Guest. Our next guest are.
I'll let you know, Philip. I'll report.
Back. Wait a minute. Dolores, can I talk to you in the kitchen, Dolores? I want to do a shout out real quick if we can. We got my girl Saba G. Scott says, hey, y'all, can I request a special shout out from Philip and Gregory to my much older brother, David Scott, in honor of one of his favorite 1979 Switch albums. Sadly, the album did not survive a TWA flight to D.C. The album warped in the overhead compartment in the D.C. heat.
Oh, damn.
She told me about this story before. She just wants you to say a special shout out to her brother, David. Say hello.
Absolutely. Not only a special shout out to David from Greg Williams over here. If David is around and he come to the show, I'll present him with a tape, a cassette copy of that album. It ain't gonna have a label on it, but I'm gonna give it to him.
Father?
Great. Cassette.
Yes.
Who has cassette players these days?
Why you think? You're gonna get as much you got of it as he is that vinyl album.
Ain't no okay. Way. That's funny.
Oh, okay.
I'm just that player. And my VHS and my DVD. Yeah. I keep it all.
Yep.
I used to love cassettes when they first came out because, you know, you could put so many of them underneath your car seat in them little containers. I still got a bunch of cassettes, you know.
I do too.
They weren't built to last very long, but they were fun when you had them, you know. They were.
Yeah, you hate when that thing got caught in the thing. It's like, wait a minute, you pull it. It's like
pull it right out the
pencil.
Yep.
Then sometimes you get just enough of it left into the cassette player to where you couldn't pull it out and you couldn't pull the cassette player either. You couldn't do anything with it. The whole thing was gone.
One thing to add to that. At least you could fix it. You can't fix no warped album.
No.
Yeah, exactly.
He's going to get that cassette, okay? I'm going to make that point.
Well, thank you. That's very black of you, Greg.
Right, okay.
Keep that music going, CJ Flash.
I got a curveball.
Okay, let's
go. They, when they hear it, they'll know it.
James, was that Zingara?
Yes, it was.
Hey,
really?
Yeah.
I heard that.
I knew it sounded familiar, but as soon as I heard James, I'm like, yeah, because the one was the hit was "Love's Calling."
Mm-hmm.
That I saw you today. Yeah, but yeah, that was interesting how that all happened with Zingara. James had got that, but he was doing demos for Barry Mann and Cynthia. And James had sung three songs. One was "Just Once," one was "Right Here and Now," and the other one was "They're Never Gonna Give You Up, Gonna Hold You." He had sang those three demos. They, Barry and Cynthia, wrote that, and all three got sent to Quincy. And "Just Once" was the one that, you know, obviously Quincy recorded and wanted to use the singer. And then "They're Never Gonna Give You Up" got recorded by Sergio Mendez. They all became hits. Mm-hmm. Sergio Mendez and Joe Pizzullo sang the lead on that. I forgot the girl's name. And then "Right Here and Now," Bill Medley, who used to be of the Righteous Brothers, mm-hmm. he sang that one. And me, James, and Phil Perry sang the background on that one. Mm. So
Phil Perry.
Yeah. Wow, Perry. Oh, me, James, and Phil Perry are on so many records, ain't even funny. Singing background.
Wow. That man right there. First of all, nothing but love to your brother, James, man. I mean, we love that.
Thank
brother,
you.
Man. Just nothing but love for him, man. If I could sing, I would sound like him. Wait, let me rephrase that. If I could sing, I would want to sound like him. There you go.
I get it.
I see Patty Austin every now and then. She'll do a show and she'll do both parts. She'll do her.
Yeah, I've seen her do that. Yeah.
It's hilarious, man. But she sounds like him as best she can. It's a fun show. It's a fun show, man.
Yep.
So, but shout out to your brother for real. God rest in peace. So, Flash, you killed him with that one. So keep it going.
Oh, here's another one. Another curveball. Got to throw this one. You just can't
keep running. I already know that one. Come on. Like a stranger passing by. If folks set you down to just one guy. Well, I knew that from the start. There's mixed emotions in your heart, babe. I hear your footsteps in the dark. You just can't keep on
Okay.
Now you know I know that one. Me and a guy named Angela Zane Giles wrote that. Now, and I'll tell you how that came. Me and Zane actually toured with us as our guitar player with Switch. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then him and I were doing a lot of writing, was getting songs and stuff placed. So him and I are playing all that. I'm playing the keyboards. And on that that song, that's me and Zane doing all the backgrounds. That's not the temp. Yeah. But, you know, Ollie Woodson sang it. But yeah, that Alma Kay produced that album, Cheetah Like a Lady. And so he asked me, him and I was doing some stuff together. He asked me to have some songs. And I actually sent him two. And one ended up on another another record, but that one ended up, it opened up that album. But yeah, that's me and Zane. That's me playing keyboards and singing background, Zane and I. Yeah, so him and I wrote that. Oh, and Tony Haynes. That's right. Okay. Me, Tony Haynes, and Zane wrote that.
And just the names you drop, and you say Ollie Woodson, mm-hmm. You said Al McKay from Earth, Wind, Fire.
Al produced that album.
Man.
Yeah. Well, see, Al, at that time, we met him because remember, Greg, he played on one of our records?
Yeah, he did. He
That's how we met him. Yeah. But he had already left Earth, Wind, and Fire at that point. Mm-hmm. And I think it was a Sheldon Reynolds that replaced him.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's right.
And then, but Al was, he started doing a lot of production stuff. So he would call me for backgrounds and stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Nice. Well, Kevin Birch is one of our longtime viewers, and he's a cousin of Marshall Thompson. So if you were looking in the chat to all the folks that are watching us out there, he said some things about Marshall. And one thing, if we can go back for just a second, he made a statement that said Marshall would always tell him that it was show business. And, you know, I always like to say it's like 95% business and 5% show. So to go back to what you were saying before, I don't care what level you're in. I was in radio for a long time, and you guys obviously in the music. Dolores teaches it. D Minor is a DJ. CJ Flash is a DJ and mixer out there. We all know it's just mostly business, folks. If you don't take care of your business, there will be no show. So,
yeah,
so just wanted to tie all that together, what you were saying earlier, all the nuggets you were dropping. If you miss any of that, about 5 minutes after the show is over, and we're not done yet, 5 minutes after the show over, you'll see the replay all over again. You just hit click, and you can watch it all over again. Or if you got time next Tuesday or next Wednesday or tomorrow night or tomorrow when you're at work, just go to the YouTube page at IRTS Space Show. Hit subscribe. It's free. And look for this show. Click on it. You can hear it all over again and watch it all over again. There you go. That's my bit. Go ahead, CJ Flash. Give us some more music.
Philip, one more.
Uh-oh.
Well, I went to a party, and what did I see? Peanut butter. All those fine people like a peanut tree.
Peter Pan tastes so peanutty because it's made from the best quality peanuts in the world.
Hey, peanut butter, anytime they can, only if it's Peter Pan.
We're Beatrice.
Okay,
so you want to know about that one?
Yes, yes, please.
It's believe it or not, that's me and my brother James, Jim Gilstrap, Phil Perry. We're all singing background on that. And I forgot the guy that sang the lead. James recommended him because they wanted to. It was James used to play with the Platters before he was famous. Played the keyboards behind him. James did a lot. Remember Night to Remember by Shalimar? James wasn't famous yet, but that's him on the keyboards.
Get out of here.
Well, James did a lot of stuff. Don't Push It, Don't Force It. With Leon Haywood, but he played with the Platters, and so the lead singer, but I can't think of his name because you know he wanted that old sound. But I'm gonna tell you that commercial was one of the biggest commercials I ever was a part of. That thing ran because a commercial would run like 13 weeks as one cycle. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if you run another cycle, that's already half a year. That thing ran for 2 years, so we had 8 cycles literally. Yeah, so that Peter Pan peanut butter was like, yeah, but that's me, James, Jim Gilstrap, Phil Perry, had a guy named Mark, Lanny Music was the name of the company, but yeah, he used us quite a bit.
Wow. Yeah, you did a lot of commercials. I'm looking at your bio. It's a Progressive Car Insurance, Huggies Diapers, Sizzler, Budweiser. ABC and CBS promos, Mitsubishi, Mazda, KFC, Mountain Dew, just on and on and on. You did the California Raisins too? Did you write that one?
Yeah, one of the California raisins. They wanted to say, like, we're back.
That
altar to the grapevine. Mm-hmm. How much longer? Wow. But I'm gonna tell you how that happened though. Because there was a while when Switch, you know, Zane and I, we went to Quest Records. We had a thing called Deco and Switch. It was Greg, Eddie, and Jody, and picked up some other guys. They went to Total Experience.
Yes.
And they did that record. But, you know, we always stayed friends and stuff. And then, but during that time period, actually, somebody heard me sing, and I had to go audition for a commercial. And I'm like, okay. So in my mind, I said, I guess it's a different, you know, different industry. I wasn't like, man, I got some hit records. What you mean? I'm a audition. I wouldn't like that at all. I'm like, okay.
Absolutely.
It was a Pacific Bell commercial. And all I did was, there's so much left to say, don't drift away. And I did this string of Pacific Bell commercials. And from that, I started doing all these other commercials. I'm like, yeah, it is a whole nother industry. Mm. Matter of fact, remember Greg talked about the royalty checks?
Mm-hmm.
I was finally getting some residuals.
Hey now.
Yeah. Right now. Yeah. You know, it's funny that you say that, because I heard a similar story from somebody that sang with you, Jim Gilstrap.
Oh yeah, Jim. Yeah.
Jim talked about how he, after he did the theme for Good Times,
right,
he was singing background with everybody.
Exactly.
But the jingle stuff is what made all the royalty checks fall out of his mailbox.
Yeah. The reason they call those residuals, because they only run for a short period of time, where royalties can continue.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, and Jim and I did. We did a ton. Like I said, he's on that Peter Pan peanut butter commercial.
Mm-hmm.
But we did a ton of stuff together. I met him actually after we did our second album. But we start working together after our fifth album.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, getting caught on the same sessions and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And matter of fact, it's funny you mentioned him. We I don't know if you heard, because he had a stroke.
Oh, man.
And, I'm sorry to hear that. But he's doing good. I called him up, and me and my wife and called him up. I said, Jim, let's go hang out. So pick a date. Wow. So me and him and me and Rebecca and him and Gloria, mm-hmm. and we both got Hispanic wives. We're both black. So two black men with two Hispanic women. And we went out and had dinner. Good, his left side is, he's still sharp mentally though.
Okay.
But his left side is paralyzed. But yeah, no, he's doing great.
I had the honor to meet him a few years back. He was singing background with Loose Ends.
Loose Ends, exactly.
Yeah. He was singing background in Loose Ends in San Francisco.
Yeah.
And I went up and met him because I got introduced to him and his legacy through a good friend of ours, Patrice Chocolate Banks.
Oh, yeah.
He's singing with Grand Central Station.
Yep.
Yeah, yeah. So she did an interview on him, and then she told me all about him. So when I met him, I was talking to him about her, and then we bonded. And so, I'm glad to hear that he's doing better.
Me and her used to do a bunch of backgrounds together with Wayne Henderson.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And Wayne produced one of my favorite groups, Pleasure.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah.
Look at us all knowing music and stuff. Look at everybody here. You know? Hey, I'm going to drop my little piece in here too. Jim Gilstrap was famously the first, he sang that first line in Stevie Wonder's You Are the Sunshine of
My
Life.
Right.
Jim Gilstrap.
Exactly.
Thanks. Yep. You're welcome. Good night, everybody. I'm done. That's all I got.
So, hey, so Jerry, I'm going to give you another one. I already know you're going to lose it.
Uh-oh.
So when do a line like that,
mm-hmm.
instead of saying good night, everybody, I said, no, this is just Dove dropping some love.
I'm writing that down.
I know you are.
Just Dove dropping some love.
You have to pay him for that one.
Hey, D-liner. No. Remember when he was trying to do this? He said, my left hand, but then you just go, you ain't got to put no hands up.
Right. Exactly. There you go.
And drop the voice just a little bit.
Hey,
remember, this is
Dove. You know what?
Hey, Philip, you saw Jerry writing it down? Don't you worry. I was writing it down too.
But you got to drop the voice, man. Come on, man.
I thought I was, man.
hey, Dolores.
Hold on, man.
Dolores, am I right? You got to drop the voice a little bit.
And drop this
tape. This is the Dove.
Let me try. Hold on.
Okay.
It's just Dove dropping some love. Oh, I made my own heart go a little faster just now. I said it myself. Who was that?
It's me. It's a quiet storm, Bobby D. It's a quiet storm.
Let me get my man CJ to play a little bit more music.
Go ahead, play. man. Do it again. Do it again.
One more time. Go ahead, Flash. Play a little more music for us, please.
Soft and warm. All right, man.
You brighten up my life. Oh, you're the key, girl, to my world. Let me tell you, there is no greater love. What you have shown me, girl, drives me wild. And I know I give you all my love, all that I build up.
Ladies and gentlemen, that is Switch, not to be confused with this Switch. Just in case you didn't know for sure, that is not to be, that's not the same group, man. That's these guys right here, Switch. That sounded good. When that one sounded good, bros.
It did. I want to slow dance now.
Okay.
Let's bring that back.
Well, you have your selection of five men here. Take your pick. Hey, now.
You know, it's funny what you mentioned, Dolores. It's true, because if you think about I Want to Be Closer, that's a true ballad. Mm-hmm. But They'll Never Be Love Over Again. You mean they still had that little, like a little cha cha groove to them. You mean?
Oh yeah.
It's a ballad, but more like a little mid tempo cha cha.
That's a nice song.
Yeah, I love that one.
Yeah. Hey, let me throw this in here, because you know, you're dropping all this knowledge, and Greg wrote this big, beautiful book here. I'm going to show you that I got mine. Yes, signed by the man. Autographed, right? Can you see that? Boom. Nice.
There you go. Yes.
So thank you very much. Let's talk about your book here, Greg.
Yes, sir.
Switch, DeBarge, Motown, and Me. Let me bring up the picture here so people can see it a little bit better. Right here. Boom. Switch, that's DeBarge, it. Motown, and Me. Talk about that.
The book came about as me wanting to get a bunch of stuff off my chest.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wanted to share the experience with those that could catch on to it, of what it was like with Switch, what it was like, you know, being with DeBarge since I was like 13, 14 years old. And definitely what it was like us being at Motown. Because something else that I wanted when I picked guys for Switch, I mean, as Philip shared, I wanted guys that could play all these instruments. Everybody played more than one anyway. All these guys could sing, you know. Definitely had have a good looking group, because girls don't scream for ugly dudes, and I wanted the girls to scream. But also, equally important, I wanted people with like minds. Mm-hmm. And fortunately, I was able to pull together a group of six humble men. The humbleness did not sustain, and more so in Bobby, because Bobby was looking for some things that he couldn't find. And I'll tell you, please understand this. We'll tell you about what was wrong with him and things that he didn't do, but Bobby was the victim. He was not the villain. Please right. understand that, everybody. Please understand that. He was the victim from the gate, and he was reacting to what had been imposed on him and what had been left out on him.
Mm-hmm.
But in the course of all that, I wanted to talk about that. I wanted to share, so people would understand that this was a group of six guys that loved each other, period. We just all happened to be talented guys, and we happened to be able to come together at a point in time because I saw something that I thought all of us could do together, you know. But the story and the stories in this book tell about things we experienced, things we learned, things we did, things that we missed out on, things that were kept from us, that were taken away from us. And most of all, that we lived. Bottom line, we lived for and through music. And that's what this book talks about. I explained who I was from the gate, you know, where my humble beginnings with my family, because I'm a poor black kid from Grand Rapids, Michigan. So I put all that in there too. But I think the most profound part of the story of the Switch book you'll find is a bunch of love between six guys. I think that's the biggest story. At least I hope I conveyed that, you know, in here, and shared some words of wisdom along the way. Somebody did hit me though. They said, Greg, after reading the book, because I'm just candid and honest. I didn't nobody up in this, but I just talked about it. Mm-hmm. And somebody said, well, Greg, why'd you throw so-and-so under the bus? I said, I didn't throw him under the bus. I met him under the bus, and I just told him, well.
Can I write that one down, too?
Hey, Greg, if not, he's going to do the replay and still write it down.
I met him under the bus.
I didn't throw him under the bus. Yeah. I met him under the bus.
Yeah. And I told you where I found him.
That's right. That's right. I like that. That's funny, man.
Clever word, sir.
No, I just told the truth. That's all. There was just a lot of truth in here, and it'll enlighten, and it will educate, and it will make you laugh, and it will make you cry. But bottom line, you will feel something. You read that book.
Wow. So where can we get it? Where can we get it, brother?
Oh, there's various places you can get it. First of all, it's in the brick and mortar stores, Border and Barnes and Noble and all of them. You can definitely get it on Amazon because that's who I co-publish a deal with. Mm-hmm. But best place I think you can get it is from my website, www.switchentertainmentworld.com. You go there, you get it. It's the same price as you get it in the other stores, except you can ask for a signed copy. And I promise you, they will bring it to me. I will sign it and we will get it to you with some love in it. Okay. Nice. Again, that's www.switchentertainmentworld.com. Mm-hmm. Get this book.
Nice. Great book too. It's a great book. And you know, it's thick, it's heavy, but it's double spaced and probably about a 10 font. So don't let that scare you folks. It's an easy read. It's an easy
probably
read.
Has some great pictures too, huh?
The only pictures are on the cover. Oh, no, I take it back. I haven't got to that far yet.
Pictures in there. Yeah.
I didn't think you were serious. I said, he's not serious. No, there are definitely pictures throughout.
Yeah. They're mixed in. I'm looking at it again. Yeah, there's pictures mixed in for sure, man. That's a beautiful thing. Beautiful thing.
Thank you.
And now, Philip, you also, since we're talking about side money and side hustles, you also did a lot of work with some films here, too. So I'm seeing My Best Friend's Wedding, Father of the Bride 2, The Wedding Singer, Little Mermaid, Shrek, Fried Green Tomato. You getting that big movie money too. Happy Feet. Stella got a groove back. Glory. Come on now. What's that about?
Well, again, this like I said, we found out they were different industries. Because
yes,
I'm gonna tell you, I've done everything in the industry except for manage. I'm not a great babysitter. I got two grandchildren who are now teenagers. You babysit them, but in the industry. Greg is managed, and he's like, okay, been there, done that, got 5 t-shirts, you know what I mean? but we did the records. And honestly, being in California, you have the opportunity to do so much more stuff. People ask me, like, how can you ever move back to Akron? And I said, I would have never, ever been able to do all the things I've done in Akron that I did out in L.A. Right. Because L.A., you know, movies are made there, commercials are made, you know, records. And so that's actually what happened. From Switch, I basically became a session singer doing lead and background with a lot of artists, which led to, you know, you remember James Newton Howard?
Mm-hmm.
James Newton Howard, before he was a film composer, he was a huge record producer. And so I worked with him doing a lot of background. So, you know, he would call me for stuff. And my best friend's wedding was a lady by the name of Bonnie Greenberg, who was... She was a music supervisor calling me for stuff. So when I did the 2 songs in My Best Friend's Wedding, I Say a Little Prayer and some ad-libs on that. Someday when I'm feeling, and I did these little ad-libs. Mm-hmm. So I was back in Chicago, and then she said, the director wants you to be in the film. I'm like, okay.
Oh, wow.
So, and I'm going to tell you what I really learned. It's funny you mentioned Little Mermaid.
First of all, what role did you play in the film? Yeah, tell us that.
Oh, I'm the wedding singer at the end of the film. You see me singing.
Okay.
At the end of the film, yeah. And when the twins are singing.
Yeah.
What happened with Little Mermaid, so, you know, we're doing like Kiss the Girl and we're doing Under the Sea and this like back in 84. Mm-hmm. And so kind of probably one of my first animated films. And so we're doing Kiss the Girl. And so they's like, Philip, why don't you do some ad-libs? And I'm sitting up there, I'm like, what, on this cartoon? I thought he was being silly. He said, no. I mean, like what? Because I mean, we're doing like, you know, like we're playing the animals, like, yeah. You know, it's like Cat Stucker, you know. And so I'm like, he said, no, do what you do. I'm like, okay. So if you listen to Kiss the Girl at the end of, I'm going, go on, kiss the girl. Go on and kiss the girl. And I was like, he said, yeah. I was like, okay. But I learned something. You know, like Greg said, he learned about holding on to the name. Mm-hmm. So let's say we're singing together on with Screen Actors Guild. 3 to 8 make the exact same money. You follow, whether it's 3 of us, up to 8. Mm. If you do an ad lib, it's like doing a solo. You get what's called a step out. So the residuals go even. So when I learned that, I'm like, they were like, Philip, can you use some ad? Yeah, but what you need?
Go ahead. Smart.
I heard that.
Mm-hmm. Go on and step out then.
But when you start learning, you, again, like Greg said, we didn't know this business. Seriously. Mm-hmm. And we you know, now looking back, now, well, yeah, I've learned a lot. But
yeah,
when we first signed to Motown, I mean, we were just happy to be a part of Motown. Absolutely. And then you start learning from there and mm-hmm. hopefully you don't make, you'll continue making the same mistakes.
Right.
That's amazing. It sounds like you could teach a master class at my School of the Arts.
Hey, girl.
Get him, Dolores. Get him, Dolores. Hey, he's your solo. Get him, Dolores. Get him.
Well, it's funny. You know, it's funny you say that. Seriously, we, Wayne was working, Wayne Henderson again. He was part of this college called the California College of Music. And he called me up. He said he was doing a lot of stuff with that college. And he called me up. He said, hey, man, why don't you come teach some vocals? I said, wait, I ain't never taught no vocals. You know what I mean? He said, Philip, just do what you do. Trust me. And so we want to, I had so many students, you know, and then I called Greg in. He was there for about 6 months. He was helping on the business side. And it's like, wow. We don't, if Wayne hadn't asked me that, I would have never thought about doing something like that. But they mm-hmm. learned so much. And I would invite them down to our rehearsals. I had them come to shows. I even had some in the studio with me. So I said, man, they were around every setting, you know what I mean? Wow. Mm-hmm. Studio, shows, came down to our rehearsals, just because the one thing, as far as with singers, the hardest thing to teach them is to be relaxed in any setting. Mm-hmm. Because if you're playing the keyboard, that's like an extension of you, but you know, the voice is vulnerable. So you start freezing up and worrying about all this stuff. You know what my motto is? Guess what my motto is?
What is it?
And I know Jerry, gonna already write it down. My motto is, we're gonna have fun. You're welcome to join us. Oh. Not cocky, but we're gonna have fun. And Greg can tell you about this. We did the show, Greg. I know you remember this, DC, with all these, I ain't gonna know anyway. It was some mess going on backstage. We go out. And never happened in our life. They booed us.
What?
They booed us. What? Just on the first song. So guess what I said? Because I'm the one that like, I'm like, hey, DC, how y'all doing? No, me or Greg would do that. Mm. I said, not a problem. We're going to do what we came to do anyway. I turned the band up. I said, hey, y'all. I said it real loud so they could hear it. I said, hey, y'all, paid rehearsal. And the band started laughing. So we started having fun. And then I did a Miles Davis. I turned around and looked at them. And then we start doing They'll Never Be. I mean, seriously, we getting into it. I'm looking at, you know, Greg and them, and they start standing up and getting into it. And this is exactly what I said. Oh, y'all decided to join us.
Okay. Nice.
And now guess what we left with?
What's that?
Take one guess. From a boo to a
standing ovation.
Of course. Standing ovation. Encore.
Because, because we're going to have fun. Y'all welcome to join us.
Welcome
not
to join.
Cocky, but we're going to have fun. You can see this.
I want to set that scene up real quick, Philip, about us getting booed. Reason we got booed, you guys, the promoters, let's see, Slave was on the show. The Mary Jane Girls was on the show.
Brothers Johnson.
Robert Johnson was on the show.
And New Birth.
And yep.
Oh,
and the promoter didn't pay nobody.
Yep.
He didn't pay nobody. Me being a manager and a business guy, I made sure I got Switch's money when we threatened to leave and got in the van to go. But keep in mind, he ain't paid nobody, ain't nobody going on. So the audience was there for a half hour, 45 minutes with no act on stage.
So but they did have that local band that came on.
Oh, yeah.
They did have a local band come on.
But legitimately, of the acts they paid to come and see, we the first ones to go on.
Right.
And they're not mad at us. They're just mad, period.
Exactly.
Because they've been stuck. So they right. booed us until we woke them up and Philip turned his back on them. And then they fell in love with us with the back of his shirt.
Nice, nice. Hey, my man Vince Robinson, who's back in Cleveland, Ohio, and watches the show with us every week, says that he's nice to hear you guys telling these backstories. He used to rock switching when he was a DJ at Harry O's in Akron. Remember that?
I definitely remember Harry O's, yeah.
Harry O's in Akron? Okay.
Yep.
Is that where the booing happened? That's not where the booing happened, was it?
Oh, no. We were in D.C., Washington, D.C.
No, that was a joke, fellas. That was a joke. Hello.
Oh, okay. Yeah, boy, that was great.
just not hitting them today. I'm just swinging and missing all night long.
Full moon, that's full moon. Don't worry about it.
Swinging and missing.
Better up.
Take the last 30 seconds out of the show. I'm going to edit that out on the replay. But Harry O's in Akron, of course.
You just told them. You said 5 minutes after the show they can watch.
No. Well, 2 minutes after this show, I'm going to go back and edit at the 8:36 mark. I ain't going out like that, man. So one more comment here. It says Dolores had a singing group. You worked together in high school. That's Byron Gibson. Dolores, yes. You holding back on us? This is your chance to audition. Look at that.
I actually sang with, they were Radiance.
Ah, you sang with Radiance?
I sang with Radiance.
Get out of here. Guys, Radiance. Yeah.
That's so funny.
Kenny and the guys?
Eric E. Kenny, Young.
Yeah. Eric. Yeah. And Taiwan, of course, took over.
Let me tell you a little, story about that, Dolores. When Philip and them left the group, I came back, and Bobby and Philip and Tommy had left the group. When I had to get the new group together to go to the next label, I came and stole Renard out of Radiance.
Wow.
I did.
Nice.
Wow. Yeah, we get a lot of talk about Radiance because
wait a minute, y'all said, "Oh wow, I ain't still no money."
But Greg, it was also those Kenny that Kenny also hipped you to Keeley.
Brought a Keeley. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
He knew a Keeley, and that's how we end up working with us.
Absolutely.
Wow,
that's amazing.
Yeah, those Radiance comes up a lot on this show. A lot of folks that are still local here that are connected to it. So
Nice.
All right, we got a few more minutes with Gregory and with Philip. So CJ Flash, you know you got to get them hits in. People have been waiting for them hits. So
you ain't said nothing.
Well, Love All Over was one of the hits, man.
Time you and I show me what you do for me, and then we'll lie. Don't try to hide your nature. No other girl could ever raise you.
You guys did have an angelic sound.
Yes,
somebody said you guys sounded like angels. You really did.
Oh, that was Jermaine when we did the harmonies when I wanted to be closer. But yeah, the honestly, which is a nice compliment for even us today, all of our colleagues that, you know, we had hits out at the same time when we do shows. They always like said, man, y'all, it's like nobody can touch you guys' harmonies, especially bands, because some people thought we were a singing group. Until they saw us with instruments on these TV shows. They're like, oh, you guys play? That's the name Switch. Yeah.
That was a singing band. Well, I have to say Crazy Bone, the Bone Thugs of Harmony, one night was on Instagram Live.
Oh, yeah.
And he just came out of nowhere and just started playing They'll Never Be and Don't Take My Love Away. And he's like, just mumbling to himself, like the lyrics. I was like, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, that's cool.
And you said you still sound like that now. You can find out for sure next Friday, next Thursday and Friday in Oakland at Yoshi's. February the 1st, there's a show at 8 o'clock. And February the 2nd, there's an 8 o'clock and a 10 o'clock. I will be at the 8 o'clock show on Friday in case you want to buy me a Hen and Coke. Or maybe just give me the money instead if I've had too many drinks. But enough about me.
Come on out and show some love to the dove, y'all.
Write that down. Just don't say it too loud because Philip will want some change behind that. So
I'm getting some change from the people that's buying your drink. They're going to give me the money first. No.
You know what I liked about that song so much is the chord changes and the beat changes, and you know, because it's like, that's kind of a cha-cha song, or you could have been slow dance of that back in the day, and then we changed the beat a little bit. It just got real intense.
Like a little ad-libs.
Yeah. The ad-libs were real cool on that one too. How long did it take to bring a song like that together? I mean, was that something that you wrote? You, like, I know that's going to be a hit, and then you just worked on it. Actually, we've had people on the show talk about working on one song for 6 or 8 months.
Oh, one song.
Let me tell you this. We were pretty much done with our album. You're the One for Me was going to be the single, right, Philip?
I Want to Be with You.
I Want to Be with You was going
to
be
I Want to Be with You was the single.
And this was our very first album. Point being, the single was already selected. Bobby and I happened to live in an apartment in North Hollywood. We had a piano in the living room, my little Fender Rhodes. One night he was in there playing, and I was on the phone with a girl in my room, and he come knocking on my door. Greg, you got to hear this song. And well, I'm a little upset because I'm talking to this girl, and I'm trying to set up tomorrow, and he want me to hear this damn song. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I get up and I go hear the song, and I immediately fell in love with the song. I mean, it was a hit. There wasn't no two ways about it. Mm-hmm. So I said, well, you need to call Mr. Gordy. So we called Mr. Gordy late that night. And he said he liked the song and all that. And he rushed us off the phone after he heard the point and heard the song. He called back about an hour or so later and told us to go in the studio the next morning. He said he'd already set it up for us to go in the studio the next morning and cut it. So we did. And pretty much Bobby had all this stuff in his head. And then they had to arrange it for the strings and the horns. And while they're moving forward with the album, I'm talking about the company, moving forward with the album, he's over there creating this. And all of a sudden, once we got it finished, we didn't know, but when it came down to it, finally Barry Gordy had chose that to be the single.
Yep.
So that didn't take a long time to cut. It didn't take a long time to create. One night he got it, and the next couple months it's on an album.
Nice.
And so that's the story behind that.
And 50 years later, we're still playing it and loving it, man. That's amazing stuff, man.
And you know, one of the things that we appreciate, there's been quite a few who've redone that, sampled it, redone I Call Your Name, sampled it. Mm-hmm. And so that's why a lot of the younger ones know who we are, because, you know, they've reached back and done, you know, our stuff and the DeBarge's stuff. But so that's a compliment to us. We appreciate. We don't like, what y'all doing? It's like, no, thank you.
Right. Yeah.
Because really that's what keeps us out there. There's you'll see at the crowd, it's a mixture. Mm-hmm. It's ones that are our age, but then you got, you know, these young ones. It's like, oh man, I love that. Mm-hmm. I forgot the guy's name on YouTube. Mm-hmm. The first time he heard, I think it was I Want to Be Closer. And he was like, I mean, literally, you can tell he's a young, I mean, who are these Switch guys, man?
Right.
And he puts on, he said, wait a minute. First he said, man, come on, the saxophone. And he stops, he goes back. And then that when the harmonies, he stopped. And he looking at the camera like, oh, man. And he's like, are you kidding me? Mm-hmm. And then that was the first thing he heard. Then he went back and critiqued us, and then he became a Switch fan.
Right then.
Yeah.
I know who you're talking about.
But I can't think of his name, but yeah.
Yeah, I've seen those videos that they're
first reaction.
Yeah,
first reaction. Yeah.
Exactly. Let's be honest about that though. So if you've been black for as long as some of those guys have been black and they never heard some, and they act like they never heard some of these songs.
Yeah,
ever.
But you gotta be honest though, Jerry. A lot of areas don't have black radio.
Exactly.
And black radio is not playing these album cut classics, or you know, just they're just playing what they play. They are what, 12 songs, maybe. Mm-hmm. So I mean, if they don't
have that, because it's a matter. I would have never heard in Grand Rapids, Michigan. Yeah, I'd have never heard Switch.
Exactly. Mm. And what's more is that we grew up in a time where we had radio that was strong, and our parents played music in the house, so there was always music going on. It's not the same these days. With they kids got to go to YouTube or TikTok or wherever they're going to get their music, and it's totally different. Totally different. So,
excuse me, just a minute. I think I'm bleeding from the cuts that you guys just gave me. But I just thought that, you know, it was hard to believe that some of these songs they talk about they never heard before and they go. I mean, you could accidentally hear that one.
I totally get it.
Your friend's house or something.
So, Jerry, I'm gonna give you a line that I've been using for years.
You're full of lines. I'm running out of paper here.
But this one probably won't work for you.
Okay.
You'll understand why in a minute.
Okay.
When people say, here, Dolores, I'm going to do it to you. Say, Philip, well, I'm sorry. I never heard a switch.
Philip, I'm sorry. I never heard a switch.
It's okay, Dolores. You know what? We went platinum without you.
You're right. That one does not relate to me. That ain't me at all.
Because uppercut. You only need it's what, 8 billion people in the world? You only need a million to go platinum.
That's
a minuscule in comparison.
And if none of them live in Grand Rapids, that's fine. There's a lot of other cities in Michigan. That's all right.
So that's been my line for years.
Okay. I see why you wrote jingles, brother. I get it.
I didn't write jingles. I just sang them.
He's quick on his feet.
Wow.
All right, Flash. I'm looking at the clock. That means we got to wrap this up because
we're having too much fun.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Once we get to a certain point, you know, nobody's watching but us after a while. So you got one song left, two songs left.
I got two or one. It's up to you. Whatever you want to do.
Well, you know, there's two of them that you got to hit. You know that, right?
I know one of them. You tell me the second one. We're going to X the last one out. We're going to save that one for last. But which one did you think?
Well, you got to play it. I'm close. Got to be closer. You got to play it.
You talking about this right here?
Yeah. How'd I know that?
Oh, I don't know.
Because they went platinum with me.
Feels like deja vu, like I played this earlier.
You did.
That's what I figured.
Yeah. You can't play it enough.
That's okay.
You can't play it enough.
Yeah. That's what we're talking about, those harmonies that Eddie came up with the arrangement.
Yeah, it's a little bit Eddie Flewellen.
Yeah. Yes.
That's what makes me want to get married or something. You know, it's just one of those, who says that to a woman? Come on,
I heard that.
All right, well, now we got one song left for real.
Yes,
but before we do that, we got to say our thank yous and all like that. What we like to do is go around the horn and let us, your hosts, say what we got to say. So the last thought. So ladies first, Dr. Dolores Thompson, tell the two gentlemen what you think about what they gave us tonight.
Well, I want to thank you, especially on behalf of the ladies. I mean, the songs that you guys wrote are classic. They're timeless. And they speak about women in a way that we have not been spoken to or spoken about since.
Yes.
I mean, it just makes our femininity validated when you guys say. So I just want to thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Nice. Really. Thank you very much.
And Dolores, if you want me to help you with a masterclass, I'd be happy to.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Oh, see. Wow. They're in town next weekend. I'm going to connect you two. Y'all work it out.
Yeah.
Wow. You're going to have a lot of downtime between Thursday and Friday. You can run over to that school. It's right around the corner from Yoshi. So I'm just saying.
It won't be this weekend, but we'll work something out for the future.
And Lord, I'll just do my hat in the ring, too.
There you go. All right, D-Minor, what you got to say? You on top of that?
Well, I don't think I could top that, but I just want to say to you guys, thank you so much for being a soundtrack to our lives. And just growing up, an introvert kid like myself was able to find a voice and find a way of talking to girls by listening to you all. So thank you all. And as a result of that, just continuing to do the radio thing. So thank you very much for just the soundtrack.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
All right. The almighty DJ CJ Flash.
Wow. It's an honor and pleasure to meet you both. Well, to meet you, Philip. We met Greg a couple of years back, but thank you guys so much for sharing musical vibrations and inspirations. You guys are definitely an inspiration to songwriters and singers and musicians alike to just strive for something greater and create a legacy that, you know, will live. So thank you guys. We really appreciate you sharing your gifts and talents with us.
And I always thank Greg. Seriously, I was 16 when I met him. Mm-hmm. I was 18 when he talked about putting this group together. And he always tells a story when we do our show. He said he had to ask my parents for me to join the group.
Wow. Wow.
And we've been buds ever since.
That's nice.
Absolutely.
Because honestly, seriously, think about it. Like I said earlier, before he came on, I said, you know, we're coming up on 51 years of hanging out with each other.
Yep.
Wow.
And, you know, you ain't going to hang out with somebody this long if you didn't like them or love them. Yeah. You know what I mean?
That's right.
So you might love them, not like them, but we love and like. So
absolutely. And respect.
Exactly.
Yeah, for sure.
Yep. That's a beautiful thing. All right. I get this last thought. Then I just want to thank you guys for coming on again. You know, this has been an educational, entertaining, funny, music filled experience. And that's what this little show is all about. You guys are great guests. And I really appreciate you taking the time to do this on behalf of us. All here, we say thank you again. This is IRTS Live. If you are out there and haven't seen this show before, again, check it out every Tuesday at 7 o'clock. We got people like this, folks talking about the legacy and talking about the music and just telling you all the behind the scenes stuff. Get the books, go see the shows. If you see these legends come through your town, please go check them out, because you never know what God has in store for any of us. And you don't want to miss out on seeing this show because you didn't feel like getting out of bed. Get your butt out of bed and sing it like me. I'm a man now.
Yes, sir.
I stole that one from you guys. I'm a man now.
So we would have never known.
See, back in the day, I could do my voice like that, but now that you got me,
I'm talking, a man now, baby.
Now that you got me doing my voice like this, I can't get
the voice. I can tell you, Jerry, Dolores, Damien, CJ, mm-hmm. We appreciate you guys too, very much for keeping our dreams and our music alive and from enjoying these moments and sharing these moments with us.
Yes.
We appreciate you all. Definitely.
All right. So Flash, give us that song and let's fade out. And remember, when you go to see Switch, it ain't these guys, okay? Go ahead, Flash. Good night, everybody.
I used to think about immature things. You know, like, do you love me? Do you want me? Are you gonna call me like you said you would? Is this really your real phone number? But you know, I'm a man now, baby, a grown man. And I came a long way. The experience taught me one thing. Taught me to hold on to my love.
IRTS Live is brought to you by CDUB HR Consulting Group, the human resources specialist, providing personalized service to building a better tomorrow. Enjoy the difference. Lifelong Medical Care, offering free vaccines for everyone 12 and over. Call Lifelong at 510-549-5454 or visit lifelongmedical.org. Check out gdubdesigns.com to get t-shirts and hoodies that make a statement. Join DJs Big Russ and CJ Flash for the world-famous show live Fridays, noon to 4 Pacific. Catch them on the following social media platforms. And if you'd like to join us as a sponsor, please email us at info@irtsshow.com.